والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. أما بعد، إن شاء الله tonight we're going to have a discussion about some of what we have covered in the previous classes. And today is Aqeedah class. Things that has to do with the belief system and the creed of the Muslim. And Al-Imam Al-Barbahari rahimahullah, he mentioned the hadith how the ummah will be split into 73 sects. And this splitting is in aqeedah and also manhaj. So we have studied, we have covered the Shia. So can anybody remember what we have studied about the Shia? Anybody can share with us?
The first sect is the Mufaddila.
Nah.
Those who prefer Ali.
Yes.
Over the rest of the companions.
Yes. The first ones are those who are called Al-Mufaddila. Al-Mufaddila means those who prefer Ali ibn Abi Talib. So Ali ibn Abi Talib, he did not like that. So this statement is not correct, even though they are not like the other sect of the Shia, like those that وَالْعِيَذُ بِاللَّهِ claim and believe that Jibreel عليه السلام made a mistake وَالْعِيَذُ بِاللَّهِ and betrayed the message. So can anybody tell us about this sect, those who believe that Ali ibn Abi Talib, the message should have gone to him? Anybody remember what the Sheikh said?
That's
the last ones. Those are the last ones. The Sheikh, he mentioned, first of all, he mentioned that Shi'ism started by a Jew. Basically, you can say the founder of Shi'ism is a Jew.
Yeah.
He was a Jew. What's his name?
Abdullah ibn Saba.
Abdullah ibn Saba. So this man, he was a Jew. And he was a munafiq. He was a hypocrite. Because he pretended that he was a Muslim, but in reality he was not. He was not a Muslim. So he accepted Islam because he had an agenda, a hidden agenda. So this man was a plant. Was a plant. So he came to destroy Islam from within. وَالْعِيَذُ بِاللَّهِ. So he's the one that started Shi'ism. And it started affecting the emotions of the people. Of course, the commoners, many of them, they don't have knowledge. They're emotionally driven. So they're easy for them to fall victim to this. But those who have knowledge, they will refute him. He cannot come to Medina and do that. Because he knows the Sahaba are there. Knowledge is there. The scholars are there. So that's why it's very important, Ikhwan, you stick around the people of knowledge. Because if you are around the ignorant, then you get affected by the innovation. You get affected by deviation. But when you are around the scholars, the people of knowledge, they know. They know the deviation. They know misguidance. So they will be able to refute it and clarify the truth. So he could not do anything in Medina. The soil was not fertile for him. So he had to go to Egypt, where he found the people who were ignorant. And this is exactly what he was looking for. As far as they are ignorant people, This type of people, they can thrive. And they can circulate their body in the falsehood. And they can propagate it. Now he started saying to the people that Uthman Ali ibn Abi Talib was oppressed by Abu Bakr and Umar and Uthman. And then this resulted in the assassination of Uthman radiallahu anhu. You see, when the fitna comes and there are ignorant people, this is what happens. When the trial and tribulation come and there are people of knowledge, they refute it. You see, they know how to deal with it. But the ignorant, they don't know. So they get carried away. And they get swept away by it. And then the fitna will increase more and more. And that's why ulama are very important, to have scholars, to have the student of knowledge, to have those who have knowledge to direct the people in the right direction. طيب. Now, Abdullah ibn Saba, the Jew, is the one who founded Shi'ism. He's the one that started Shi'ism. And then the firqa, the sect that I was talking about, the Sheikh mentioned, these are from the extremists. From the extremist of the Shia are those that believe, may Allah protect us, that Jibreel made a mistake. He betrayed the message. How can Jibreel, the one that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala trusted with his message, betray the message? Doesn't make sense. How can a trustworthy angel, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has entrusted him with his revelation, to betray the message? So they are liars. So they believe that Jibreel alayhi salam, instead of delivering the message to Ali ibn Abi Talib, he delivered the message to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And there is another sect, the brother Amir's mention. Can anybody tell me about those, the most extreme of them all? Yes, those who are more extreme than them. Yes, those that believe that Ali ibn Abi Talib is an ilah, wal'iyadhu billah, is a deity. This is kufr. Anybody who believes that anyone of the creation is a deity is a kafir. And also he's a mushrik. Because now he has joint partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The only deity is Allah. La ilaha illallah. There is no deity worthy of worship except Allah. All other deities that are being worshipped beside Allah, they are false deities. So these extremists among the Shia, they went to the extent to say Ali ibn Abi Talib is Allah. وَالْعِيَذُ بِاللَّهِ نَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنْ ذَلِكَ. So Ali ibn Abi Talib, what did he do? He burned them. He dug up ditches, filled them with the fire, and they threw them in it. And then Abdullah ibn Abbas, what did Abdullah ibn Abbas tell him? تفضل. Yeah, he told him that the hadith. He told him the hadith of the Messenger of Allah. Anybody remember the hadith? لا يعذب بالنار إلا رب النار. لا يعذب بالنار إلا رب النار. No one has the authority to punish with the fire and burn with the fire except the Lord of the fire, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So did Abdullah ibn Abbas disagree with Ali ibn Abi Talib in killing them, or he did not disagree? He did not disagree, just the method. They should be killed with the sword, not with the fire, because of the hadith. So you have now an idea about Shia. Right? Then the Sheikh, he spoke about two sects after that. Can anybody remember what the Sheikh spoke about after he finished talking about the Shia? Al-Qadariya. Ahsant. Yes. Al-Qadariya. Write it down. Al-Qadariya. And Al-Qadariya comes from what? Al-Qadar. What is Al-Qadar? The decree. The decree. And the decree of Allah can be good, can be bad, right or wrong. In the hadith of Jibreel, when he asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam about al-Iman, tell me about Iman, right? What did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam say? What did he say? When Jibreel asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam about al-Iman, what did he say? What did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam say? Yes, fadda. To believe in Allah. To believe in the angels. To believe in the books. To believe in the messengers. No, last day. To believe in the last day and? Good or bad. He said, Al-Qadr khayrihi wa sharrihi. To believe in Al-Qadr, good or bad. Because Al-Qadr can be good, can be bad. And what's bad is not actually bad. It's good. When you look at it, it's good. Sometimes you may dislike it, but actually good for you. And that's why the poet, he said, رُبَّ دَارَّةٍ نَافِعَ رُبَّ دَارَّةٍ نَافِعَ. Sometimes you may get hit by a calamity, and it's good for you. Yes, it's good for you. Some people, when they are far away from Allah, they don't pray, they don't fast, they don't do any good deeds, and they get stricken by a calamity that humbles them. And they turn back to Allah and they become righteous. How many people? Is it good or bad? It's good. So now al-Qadariya, who are they? Who are they? And how many sects are there of al-Qadariya? There are two. Sheikh mentioned them. What's the first one? Huh? No, not no. Al-Nufat. Al-Nufat. Okay. Al-Nufat. You know what Nufat means? What does Nufat mean? Nufat. How many times I told you, brothers, the book is just a meme. You have to rely on your memory. The book is just a meme. Rely on your understanding and your memory. That's why knowledge does not evaporate. Once you memorize it, you understand it, it's going to stay. The book, if you rely on the book all the time, you're never going to get it. The book is just a meme. You use it. You read after you finish, you go through it, and that's it. You don't go back, and you rely on the book. It's not good. Okay, so nufat comes from what? The verb nafa. Nafa is to negate. To negate. And what's the opposite of nafa? Huh? Affirm, which is ithbat. And that's why they say la ilaha illallah has two pillars, right? What's the first one? Al-nafiyu wal-ithbat. Nafi wal-ithbat. Negation and affirmation. What is the negation in La ilaha illallah? La ilaha illallah is affirmation. Ahsant. Why are they called nufat? The negators. Why are they called nufat?
That they negate the bad of Allah.
They negate what?
That they say that Allah they don't actually do evil with Allah.
You're very close. You're very close, but. You want to be specific Denigrate what? Al-Qadr. Denigrate Al-Qadr. Because Al-Qadr, what did we say? Is either good or bad, right? Okay. Is the bad part of Al-Qadr or not? So it is Qadr, right? So denigrate Al-Qadr. How do they negate Al-Qadr? Anybody can tell us how they negate Al-Qadr? Bismillah.
They say no, they don't have no choice?
No. These are the ones that negate Al-Qadr. The, you're talking about the other sects.
They say,
how
can Allah give a Qadr that's bad? Yeah, so they reject that.
Because they don't want to attribute evil to Allah. You understand? They don't want to attribute evil to Allah. So they claim that they are freeing Allah from deficiencies. But is it true or false? It's false. Because Allah created good and evil. He created good and evil to test us. وَنَبْلُوكُمْ بِالشَّرِّ وَالْخَيْرِ فِتْنَةً وَنَبْلُوكُمْ بِالشَّرِّ وَالْخَيْرِ فِتْنَةً. And Allah said in the Quran, and we test you with shar, evil and good as a test. So Allah created good and created evil. Shaytan, is he good or bad? Evil. But Allah created him to test us. Yeah. It's a test. طيب. Now, this Al-Qadariya, they are Mu'tazila. Remember that they are from Al-Mu'tazila. Al-Mu'tazila. And Al-Mu'tazila, they have issues in Aqidah. They have issues in Aqidah. Al-Mu'tazila, they affirm the names of Allah, but they negate the attributes. I'm going to repeat again. They affirm the names of Allah and they negate the attributes. Okay? They affirm the name of Allah. You say Allah is Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim, Al-Malik, Al-Quddus, Al-Salam, Al-Mu'min, Al-Muhaymin. They affirm all the names of Allah. Do Ahl al-Sunnah affirm the names? Yes, they do. What about Al-Jahmiyyah? Al-Jahmiyyah, they don't. Remember this. Al-Jahmiyyah, the followers of Al-Jahm ibn Safwan, they don't affirm the names or attributes altogether. They don't affirm any names of Allah. And they don't affirm any attributes. Zero. Mu'tazila, they affirm what? The names, and they negate what? Attributes. The attribute of Allah, for example, Allah is Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim. These are his name. What's the attribute? Mercy. Mercy is the attribute. Right. So they don't affirm the attribute of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Or Allah descends in a way that befits His majesty. They negate it. They even negate that Allah speaks. Now, we're going to go in order. Jahmiyyah, they negate the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why do they negate the names? What's the reason? Why? Why do they negate the names of Allah? Why? Yes, because they believe if you affirm the names, this would necessitate that there will be multiple deities. But this is jahl, this is ignorance. Because Allah is the same as Ar-Rahman, right or wrong? Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim, Al-Malik, Al-Quddus, Salam, Al-Mu'min. Is it multiple deities or one ilah? One ilah. And he has different names. Like, for example, the human being. A man can be a husband, right? He can be what? What else?
Father.
And what else?
Brother.
A brother. He can be? Uncle. Yeah, brother-in-law, son-in-law, other than that, right? Is it different man or just one man? Same man. So if this is the case with human, what about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Allah is far greater than that. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay, second, the same as al-Mu'tazila. Jamia al-Mu'tazila, they don't affirm any attribute of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why? Anybody can tell us why? You gotta understand these people, they did not stick to the Quran and the Sunnah. That's why they deviated. What they did, they relied on their intellectual reasoning. On their intellectual reasoning. And that's why they deviated. So why they reject and they negate the attribute of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Why? Anybody can tell us?
They don't want to they don't want to make Allah seem like he's human.
Right. Because according to them, if you affirm, you are mujassim. You know what mujassim is? Mujassim.
You're attributing a body to Allah.
Yes, you're attributing a body to Allah. Ah. If you say, for example, Allah speaks and Allah hears. So according to them, if you affirm, you are attributing a body to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if you say he speaks, they say it's because they delved into rhetoric and philosophy. And that's why they deviated. They say because if you say he speaks, this would necessitate he will have a tongue. Who told you that? So now they are coming up with their own reasoning. Allah did not mention in the Quran like that. Allah said he speaks in a way that befits his majesty. Yes, Allah speaks in a way that befits his majesty. This is the aqeedah of al-Sunnah. Allah comes on Yawm al-Qiyamah in a way that befits his majesty. So we can use this principle for all the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we don't negate. And that's why one of the imams of the Salaf, he said, Al-Mu'attila are those who negate the attribute of Allah, like Jahmiyyah and Al-Mu'tazila. He said they are like a man who claims that he has a palm tree in his yard. Right? So the people, they told him, صِفْ لَنَا هَذِهِ النَّخْلَةِ. They asked him, they said, can you describe to us this palm tree? He said, it doesn't have a trunk. It does not have what? A trunk. It does not have any leaves. It does not have any fruits. Nothing. They told him in the end, then you don't have a tree. If this tree doesn't have a trunk, doesn't have no leaves, doesn't have no fruits, nothing, no dates, then does this man really have a palm tree? He doesn't have a palm tree. So, if you say Allah does not speak, and he will not come, and this and that, you can't say this, you can't say that, then you don't have an ilah anymore. You still have an ilah? You don't have an ilah. Because you have taken all the attributes from this ilah, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why Imam Al-Qayyim, rahimahullah, he said, Al-Mu'attilu ya'budu adaman. Al-Mu'attilu ya'budu adaman. Wal-Mushabbihu ya'budu sanaman. Imam Al-Qayyim, rahimahullah, he said, Al-Mu'attil, the one who negates the attribute of Allah, he worships nothingness. He worships what? Nothingness. Nothing. Does he worship anything? Don't worship anything. If you say Allah does not hear, He does not see, He does not speak, na'udhu billah min dhalik, then you don't have an ilah anymore. That's it. You don't worship anything. Al-Sunnah, alhamdulillah, He affirmed to Allah what he affirmed to himself in the Quran, affirmed the tongue of his messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, without delving into the reality of that attribute, because we don't know how. As Imam Malik rahimahullah, when the man asked him in the masjid, he said, Ya Aba Abdillah, Ar-Rahman ala al-Arsh istawa, kayf istawa? Ya Aba Abdillah, Ar-Rahman, the most gracious, he rose over the throne. How did he rise over the throne? It's not permissible to ask a question like this. Sheikh Al-Uthaymeen rahimahullah, he said the Sahaba, they had more taqwa, more fear of Allah. And they had more knowledge about the deen. They never asked the Prophet ﷺ a question like that. So this man, he had the audacity to ask a question like that. That's why Imam Malik, he removed him from the masjid. Because this man is dangerous. If he stays in the masjid, he will contaminate the masjid with his bid'ah, innovation. And the people, they will listen to him. And they will be affected by his bid'ah. That's why it's permissible to remove Ahlul Bid'ah from the masjid. If they come to recruit the people, like Jama'at Tabligh or any of them, we remove them from the masjid. We will not let them come here, do their program, or whatever the case is. Bayan and all that, 3 days, 40 days and all that. No. They come to listen, alhamdulillah, they're welcome. But they come to recruit the people, no. We will not let them have their lay their eggs and have their chicks, as they say. طيب. So Al-Imam Malik rahimahullah, he told him الاستواء معلوم والكيف مجهول والسؤال عنه والإيمان به بدعة والإيمان به واجب والسؤال عنه بدعة. He said to the man, Allah rose over the throne is known, because Allah said so in the Quran. Allah said, الرحمن على العرش استوى, the most gracious rose over the throne in a way that befits his majesty. So it is known in the Quran that Allah rose over the throne. والكيف مجهول. How he rose over the throne is unknown, مجهول. We don't know the reality of it. والإيمان به واجب. And to believe that Allah rose over the throne is واجب, is obligatory. والسؤال عنه بدعة. And to ask the question how is an innovation in the religion. And then he had the man removed from the masjid. Imam Malik رحمه الله. So the ulama, they have taken a principle from this statement of Imam Malik. In every attribute of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that we affirm it as Allah affirmed it in the Quran and upon the tongue of his messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, without negating it, من غير تعطيل, without negating it, ولا تمثيل, or likening Allah to his creation, ولا تكييف, or without delving into the reality of that attribute, how and this, no, but no knowledge. We affirm it, but we don't delve into the reality of that attribute because we have no knowledge from the affairs of the unseen. We don't know how Allah speaks, how he hears, how he will come on Yawm al-Qiyamah and the like. These are from the attribute of Allah that the reality of that only Allah knows about. Nobody knows. So we don't delve into something we have no knowledge about. You see, Al-Sunnah, Alhamdulillah, they abide by Al-Kitab wa-Sunnah. They don't go beyond that. من غير تعطيل, without negating them, without likening Allah to his creation, without delving into the reality of those attributes. This is the way of Al-Sunnah, Alhamdulillah. But the people of Bid'ah, they negate. Al-Jahmiyya, they negate all the attributes of Allah. Al-Mu'tazila, the same way. They affirm only the names. طيب, Al-Mu'tazila comes from Al-I'tizal. Al-I'tizal means to seclude yourself from someone. And the reason they were called Mu'tazila, because Hassan al-Basri, rahimahullah, he had a student. He had a student who differed with his teacher, Hassan al-Basri, in regards to the one who committed a major sin. Because the one who commits a major sin, like for example, someone drinks alcohol, this person has committed a major sin, right or wrong. Okay, what is the ruling of this person in according to Al-Sunnah? What is the ruling? He's still a Muslim, even though he has deficiency in his iman. He has deficiency in his iman. فهو مؤمن بإيمانه فاسق بكبيرته. Remember this. فهو مؤمن بإيمانه فاسق بكبيرته. He is a believer with the iman that he has with him, and he is a fasiq, a sinner with the major sin that he has with him. Look at al-adl, justice of al-sunnah. They're not extreme, like al-khawarij, mu'tazila, al-murji'a, pious. Al-iman is a statement of the tongue, belief of the heart, followed by action of the limbs. It increases with good deed and decreases with what? Sins. Decreases. They didn't say taken away. No, like al-khawarij. Because here, Ahl-Sunnah, they differ from al-khawarij. Because al-khawarij, either you have it or you don't have it. You have to understand. Al-khawarij, you commit a major sin, you're out. You're out. Very important to know the sect. You can never be someone from Ahl-Sunnah and you don't know the sect. There's no way you can be. You don't know Jama'at Tabligh, you don't know Al-Ikhwan, you don't know all these deviant sects. You can't be. Because now, if you don't have that Furqan, that criterion, they take you for a ride easy. And you get deceived by them. Because many of them, they may look like Ahl-Sunnah. They have Amama, they have Ilihya, beard. They look like they are from the period of the Sunnah, but they are Ahl-Bid'ah. How do you know them? When they start talking. When you start talking, you will know. By their fruits, you will know them. طيب. Going back, Ikhwan, we said, Wasil ibn Ata. Wasil ibn Ata is the student of Hassan al-Basri. And he disagreed with his teacher, Hassan al-Basri, about this issue of the one who commits a major sin. Because Ahl-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah, they don't take him out. They don't say he's kafir. He's a sinner. He has iman, but his iman is deficient. طيب. Wasil ibn Ata, he came with a new type of iman. He said that this man who committed major sin, he does not deserve the title of mu'min, and he does not deserve the title of disbeliever. You understand or you don't understand? So we don't give him the title of a mu'min, and we don't give him the title of a disbeliever kafir.
The student of Hassan al-Basri?
Yes. And that's why they called what? Mu'tazila. Because they secluded themselves from the imam of the sunnah of that time, Hassan al-Basri, rahimahullah. So this is how they deviated. طيب. Now, they say, we don't give him the title of a mu'min, and we don't give him the title of what? Kafir. So he is in a position in between. Very confusing, isn't it? So we ask al-Mu'tazila, if this man dies, where are we going to put him? Okay, if he dies, are we going to put him in the graveyard of the Muslims or the non-Muslims? We cannot put him in between. It's either he's going to be with the Muslims or with the non-Muslims, right? طيب. So, it's very confusing. These are al-Mu'tazila. نعم, these are al-Mu'tazila. So now you know who they are. And they have other issues. This is some of the issues that they have. طيب. Now, when it comes to this dunya, this worldly affairs, they say that in this dunya, we don't say that he's a believer, we don't say he's a disbeliever. It's like neutral, in a neutral position. But in the hereafter, they agree with Khawarij. They say he's a kafir. In the akhirah, he will be in the fire forever. Al-Khawarij, the difference between them and Mu'tazila, Al-Khawarij, they deem him to be kafir in this dunya and the next. Mu'tazila, they say in this dunya, we don't give him the title of a believer, nor do we give him the title of the disbeliever. So they take that neutral position. You understand? Very important information. Should write them down. If you have a good memory, you can memorize it because this is very important. Wallahi, very important. Tayyib, it took us a long time to learn these things. So, barakallahu feekum. Write it down. Write it down. If you have a good memory, memorize it. Tayyib. So these are the Mu'tazila, ikhwan. These are the Mu'tazila. And they have other issues. They have other issues. Like, for example, they believe Allah cannot be seen on Yawm al-Qiyamah. They say Allah cannot be seen on the Day of Judgment. While Ahl al-Sunnah wal al-Jama'ah, they all agree that Allah will be seen on Yawm al-Qiyamah. Allah will be seen on Yawm al-Qiyamah. And the believers, they will see Allah with their own eyes. As Allah said in the Quran, in Surah Al-Qiyamah, وُجُوهٌ يَوْمَئِذٍ نَاظِرَةٌ إِلَىٰ رَبِّهَا نَاظِرَةٌ. Faces on that day, they will be radiant, looking at their Lord. And also the hadith, Rasulullah he said, إِنَّكُمْ لَتَرَوْنَ رَبَّكُمْ كَمَا تَرَوْنَ الْقَمَرَ لَيْلَةِ الْبَدْرِ. You will surely see your Lord as you see the full moon. You will have no problem looking at your Lord. طيب. المعتزلة, they say Allah will not be seen. Because he said in the Quran to Musa, alayhi salam, when Musa asked him, he said, oh my Lord, let me see you. He said, لن تراني. You will not be able to see me. He said, لن تراني. You will not be able to see me. How do you respond to this? In this dunya. In this dunya. Jazakallah khair. So you will not be able to see me in this dunya, in this world. He did not say to Musa, you will not see me, you will not be able to see me in the hereafter. Here, in this world. Impossible for anyone to see Allah in this world. And Prophet ﷺ said in the hadith, he said, if Allah remove the veil on his face, subhanahu wa ta'ala, the light on his face will burn everything that his eyes extend. Subhanallah. Burn everything. So there is no way that somebody can see Allah in this dunya. There is no way. But in the hereafter, the believers, they will see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then they use another ayah. They said, Allah said, لا تدركه الأبصار. لا تدركه الأبصار. What does لا تدركه الأبصار mean? Anybody can translate. لا تدركه الأبصار. Can anybody translate this? لا تدركه الأبصار. لا تدركه الأبصار. تدركه means encompass. Means visions cannot encompass him. Visions cannot encompass him. That's what it means. Vision cannot encompass him. But look, subhanallah, whenever a person from the people of Bid'ah uses a statement that he thinks is for him, but the reality is against him. It's against him. Because they use this as a proof that Allah cannot be seen. He said, Allah said, لَا تُدْرِكُهُ الْأَبْصَارُ. He said, vision cannot encompass him. So we tell them, يَا مُعْتَزِلَ. Allah said, it cannot encompass him. He did not say it cannot see him. And there is a big difference between encompass and see. those who know the English language. What does encompass mean? Know of.
Grasp
something in its entirety. Mm. You understand?
Yeah.
It's not easy. Like, okay, when someone says, I have seen the ocean, did he encompass the ocean or did he actually see the ocean? Did he encompass it? Or did he just saw part of it? He saw part of it. Likewise, Allah will be seen, but he will not be encompassed. That's how the ulama responded to them. Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen and others. طيب. And we're going to stop here. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us all العلم النافع والعمل الصالح. الحمد لله رب العالمين. صلى الله على محمد وآله وصحبه وسلم.